Bonsoir, bienvenue à cette soirée de la SMPTE. Aujourd'hui, on va parler des technologies d'archivage et les défis d'envoyer de larges fichiers par Internet. On a deux présentateurs ce soir. On a Hyson Ziya-Chakiri, qui est vice-président senior développement des affaires chez Spectralogic, qui est aussi un associé clé depuis 1984. Il va nous parler de la technologie LTO7 et de son histoire, son historique de son évolution. Il va nous parler aussi de la technologie T10K versus la technologie LTO7 et le TS1150 au niveau des technologies de ruban, qui sont les nouvelles technologies émergentes sur le marché. Et aussi de nous parler de la convergence de l'archivage d'objets, d'API, cloud et de formats ouverts LTFS. Par la suite, on va avoir Jonathan Solomon, qui est ingénieur senior chez Aspera, qui est une compagnie d'IBM, qui va nous faire une présentation, lui, de son côté, en fait, de nous parler, une présentation 101 au niveau des défis d'envoyer de larges fichiers sur l'Internet et vers les solutions de cloud. Et par la suite, nous faire une présentation des technologies qui existent pour nous faciliter l'envoi de fichiers vers l'Internet. Et on va finir le tout avec une présentation portant sur la sécurité et en fonction des environnements d'aujourd'hui, une présentation des best practices. Voilà, donc je vais laisser la parole à M. Hyson.
All right. Good evening. As Denny said, my name is Hossein Ziya-Chakiri. I am with a company called Spectralogic. So tonight, basically, what we're going to talk about, as mentioned, the title said, we're going to give you a little bit of update on LTO7, where things are, and a little bit on its background and certain characteristics and what have you. And then after that, we may do a little bit of comparison of LTO7 with some of the enterprise drives. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with enterprise tape drives. In fact, if you can raise a hand if you've heard of them and have you worked with them, great, great. Then a good bit of knowledge hit there. And then finally, what we're going to do, which is the main topic of this presentation, is talk about object storage and how to extend object storage to tape. It's something that these days object storage is there's quite a bit of conversation around it, and we're going to talk about this value proposition and how it works and fits in the environment and what we think and how tape plays into that. So that's what the main core of this presentation is. With that said, if you don't mind, let me just obligatory thing, talk about Spectralogic, who we are. We are a company in Boulder, Colorado. Our core business, our core function is basically to develop secondary and tertiary storage. It basically means nearline storage and tape libraries. That is our core business. That's what we've been doing for over 30 years. And it is a private company. We do not bring any outside investment. We have not brought any outside investment to Spectralogic. More than anything, it is because we are such an engineering-driven company. Our culture is so much on that side where we feel that if we bring outside investment, that might just tie our hand to how we spend our money, basically on technology development and innovation. So that's really the core of it. And then, of course, we've manufactured everything in Boulder, Colorado, and it's supported there. So that's, now that it's out of the way, we'll go ahead and jump into the presentation. So with that said, let's talk about LTO7. You guys are all familiar with LTO technology, I'm assuming, or have some degree of experience with it. It is basically going to come out toward the end of this year. Our expectation is that over the next couple of months, we will receive a number of tape drives, and typically, when we receive it, we spend a number of months basically testing it and certifying it, play with it, and trying to characterize its behavior and its solidity. So with that said, LTO, I was told to share a little bit about the background. It is basically a consortium. It started about, a number of years ago, about seven different companies. And the whole idea was, prior to LTO, there had been many companies that had tape technologies. It was a single source. And the single source issue, that causes a lot of issue. In terms of quality, it may not be as good because it does not have any competition or anything, or in terms of innovation for competitiveness. So once LTO Consortium was created, it brought a lot of those value to the industry. not only to the end user, but also to those of us who develop tape libraries, because we needed that competitiveness so it raises the quality of the technology and the prices down. And that's where the value of the consortium is. It is open, there are still three companies that are the core developers of LTO tape drives and a number of sources that manufacture the tape media itself. And that's where the value proposition is, the competitiveness and drive and quality. So with that said, LTO, we are now at LTO 7. And the roadmap up to LTO 10 has been defined as well in terms of expectations on the density and on the performance. So the LTO 6 capacity is 7 is to be about 6 terabyte. It's somewhere between 6 to 6.4 terabyte, in fact. And the performance numbers are going to be somewhere between 300 and 315. We will basically qualify those numbers as soon as we receive them. In terms of read write compatibility, the same thing. It will continue with the tradition of being fully backward compatible one generation prior. So it will do read write to LTO 6. And the second generation basically read only. So that will continue with that. And the one major change is that with LTO 7, all the media is going to be barium ferrite. Up to LTO 6, metal particle, assuming everybody's familiar with that, metal particle was the main medium based, but at LTO 6, we also introduced barium ferrite. And it was the political scenes between the barium ferrite medium and the metal particle and the price model where the industry agreed to stay at 2.5. The barium ferrite could have gone to 3 terabyte, but it is something that on political scenes it decided to set 2.5. But with the LTO 7, we are back. We basically are recovered where we are at 6 terabyte minimum to 6.4 terabyte. Another major change in LTO 7 is the head change. Where it used to be GMR, it is now going to be TMR, and it is going to be 32 channel, basically, on the head. So that will bring a lot of value proposition to the technology. We'll talk about it in terms of access to the data, and we'll talk about basically the effect that it has on the reliability and affecting the age of the tape cartridge. One thing I wanted to highlight basically here is that the performance, while the capacity, while it basically doubled from 400 to 800 and 1.5 terabyte to, this was an anomaly, basically, if you will. But the more important part was the transfer rate. The performance of tape drives is more than, it's a device that's been designed for streaming. So its performance is more than anything is measured basically based on the streaming into another way. And it was incremental increases with previous generation. But one of the things that the Spectrologic we pushed quite a bit on the consortium was we now put so much data on the medium itself that we need the performance also to increase and double up rather than incremental increases, so that the access pattern or the access actually to the medium itself when you try to find something that needs to be need to be doubling up relative to the capacity as well. So that's something that they did. And the expectation is, especially with this new head technology, that will continue into the next generation. So I just wanted to highlight that. So the value proposition is basically, if just to put it into real life issue, is if you try to move, archive, or backup 100 terabytes within 8 hour window with LTO 5, it will, you know, if you had 13 drives, it will take about 34 cartridges to do that task. So you try to do the same task with LTO 7, you only need 5 drives and 7 cartridges. So in terms of cost moving forward, that's a significant change, basically, in terms of pushing the data into it. Well, it will give you more time, you will be able to access data faster, but at the same time, it saves you quite a bit in terms of number of slots and number of tape drives. That obviously has direct correlation with the cost of the archive, because as you're familiar with that, you know, especially these days with the current model, you do pay for the cost of archiving, both not only both on the software but also on the tape library. So that is associated with quite a bit of saving. And if you try to do the same thing with LTO6, it is basically, it will require 9 tape drives and 16 cartridges. And again, the difference is 5 drives and 7 cartridges. So you can see that there is, especially changing from LTO 5 to 7, there's a significant change that brings to the table. So a significant change with LTO7 is changing the head. We now have 32 channels in there. And with 32 channels, basically, is for one thing, you can write data a lot faster. And the way it basically works is that you have the head, and the head is going to have to be adjusted basically over the tape. And with having more heads, it does not have to cross the path of tape. Basically, it reduces the number of time that it will go up and down because it drives down more tracks. So that alone changes basically the amount of movement of tape over the head, and that basically by itself changes the wear factor, where the head does not wear as much. That's one great benefit of that. Then the other thing is the transfer rate. The data transfer will be able to put quite a bit more data in there. And when you put those things together, basically we should be, you know, have an expectation that the life of the tape card, the storage medium, the tape drive, tape media itself, and the tape head is going to increase quite a bit. So we have an expectation of that. And that mixed with the type of medium, barium ferrite, you'll see that, you know, we have an expectation of much greater quality, basically. Before we go talk about the barium ferrite medium and head technologies, I thought I put this one slide together. Dennis suggested that we should discuss LTO7 relative to the enterprise drives. Seems like a lot of folks here have had experiences or have a knowledge of enterprise tape drives. These tape drives are very heavily actually used in the high-performance computing and supercomputing environment. In fact, one of the things I wanted to share is that the roots of LTO7 is, in fact, in TS-1150. That's where it came from. IBM shared a lot of its technology early years of the consortium, shared a lot of their technology. But these tape drives are basically, they've been designed to work in a much harsher environment where there are a lot of small files that constantly have to be read. So if you go into high-performance computing, they have a lot of small files, and they load and unload, read a file, they put it back together. The load exchange and reading files is quite higher than this environment. So they have other features with enterprise drive, and that is that they read backward as well, because that will give them, you know, quicker access to their data and better, you know, faster access to the data. The other thing is they have different tape cartridges, different size of tape cartridges. So if the access to tape is very important, they use a smaller capacity tape cartridges, and that'll give them a little bit faster access. So it's being used in those environments. We are beginning to see deployment of some enterprise drives in media and entertainment. There are some of the larger houses that they're doing it because there are cost benefit in terms of power and cost, especially when you use a TS-1150 in terms of when you consolidate the number of slots and the number of tape drives associated with power and all that. It actually larger installations than the cost per gigabyte based on an enterprise tape technology is lower than that of LTO. So we do see that. But while the cost of medium itself is a little bit more expensive, cost per gigabyte actually becomes lower.
Right. So people who look at TS technology So let's be clear, all of these technologies, they sit at the very tail end of your whole business flow. Your life is happening up here at the 0 to 30 day mark, right? So you want to make sure that whatever you put over here is as efficient as possible, because you want to stay out of it as much as possible as well. And so that's where TS 1150 becomes very attractive in the long term, because it will give you that space reclamation, it gives you those performance speeds, and now going
to
talk about the reformat.
Yep. Go ahead, as far as reformatting the older tapes.
Right.
And
so with LTO, you can reformat that tape and rewrite over it, everything's great. But it's always going to be 2.5 terabytes
right.
of LTO6, 6 to 6.4. Once it comes out, we'll know the real number, but that's all it's ever going to be with LTO. With TS, however, when the new technology comes out, so TS 1160 is actually projected, it's going to be, they're talking about claim 70% of the delta. So now you can format a tape that was 10 terabytes and you'll get 17 terabytes. So rather than having to grow physically your hardware, you can reuse the same hardware and just keep growing within that. So from a long-term perspective, for people that have to house many, many digital assets for copious amounts of time, it really becomes a no-brainer. Pay up front, because it's a little bit more expensive, but the total cost.
So the other aspects to know about it is, one is basic, load-unload cycle. That basically, you know, testifies basically the hardness of the tape drive and how it's been designed basically for harsher environments. So its life cycle should be quite a bit more. But other things would be good to know is the TS11, the enterprise drive from IBM, the TS1150 basically. There are two manufacturers. One is StorageTek, or what is now known as Oracle. The other one is IBM. And the things have changed quite a bit, where TS1150 now holds about 60 to 65% of the market, whereas Oracle tapes, or T10K, holds about 40% of the market. Now, there is one significant dynamic that is going on in the market, and that is that the IBM, they have the volume of their LTO drives, where one of the biggest thing about tape drives is the head itself. Head itself is one of the hardest pieces to manufacture. So having the volume and knowing that the head of the LTO tape cartridges are manufactured on the same production line as the enterprise drive, that is one significant advantage that IBM has, because not only they manufacture the LTO, but they also manufacture the TS drive. Therefore, they will be able to manage or produce basically the TS1150 at lower cost, and it's more guaranteed. Whereas Oracle basically relies on other manufacturers for its head production, so they have to depend on HP, and whether HP stays in this or not, that, you know, that's something that's a dynamic that would be interesting to see what happens. But at least we know that TS1150 is safe and secure in terms of its roadmap, and in fact they have announced two generations ahead. So that's one important thing to know. And if you look at it, basically the LTO7 also in terms of capacity and performance is pretty much close, in some ways surpass basically the T10K. So that's another thing to know. So when you do choose a tape or tape technology for your environment, knowing basically what the company is and its future and their roadmap basically has everything to do with the investment protection that you put into it.
Well, the LTO also gives, you've got it there on your one of your the third last bullet there, library compatibility.
Mm-hmm.
LTO gives you much more variety of vendors. So because it is an open standard and open technology, you're a lot more free to shop around.
especially since the capacities and performance are now getting much closer to the TF,
yep.
The enterprise table.
So let's talk about barium ferrite. How many of you folks are familiar with barium ferrite? Okay. So up to this point, metal particle basically was technology, and it did its job, but in terms of being able to increase the density of it, it basically has run out of gas. The density has a lot to do with the size of the particles, and then also the other issue that was associated with metal particle is that it was prone to environmental factors. You had to keep tape cartridges basically in environments where environmentally controlled in terms of heat, humidity, and what have you. So what barium ferrite basically does, it has, first of all, the particles are a lot smaller, about 20 nanometer, and also one of the things that they use is that they can disperse the particle over the medium a lot more evenly. And what that does gives basically the ability to increase the density of the cartridges. Another aspect of barium ferrite is that by design, the material itself is oxidized. And what that means is that humidity and heat does not affect it as much. In fact, all the accelerated testing that they've done with barium ferrite is that over the 30-year span, basically, they have not seen any degradation in terms of signal quality that you read from it. And that's a major change, basically, with barium ferrite. And, of course, having the smaller particles, it allows it with newer generations of, basically, heads and what have you, is that they will be able to increase the density quite a bit more. So that's an important thing. So LTO7 and on is all going to be barium ferrite. In fact, LTO7 will not read metal particles. So that's something that is a major consideration that we should know. In fact, we tried, basically, for a lot of folks who did buy previous generation LTO6, our strong recommendation was that they should stay or buy barium ferrite, not only for reliability purposes, but also for backward compatibility. So that's a major issue to know. Anything else you think we should add here? So in terms of the density, are you folks familiar with super paramagnetic effect? Have you heard that term before? If you look at this technology, basically, what super paramagnetic effect is that if the particles are so small and you put so many of these bits together, there comes a point that if you get them close to each other, they can actually affect one another, or they're small enough that you cannot, basically, they lose their magnetization. And in this technology, we have reached there, whereas in tape technology, we're about 100 times below that. So whereas disc is about 600, 600 gigabit per square inch area, tape is about 6. So we have quite a bit of room to increase the density of tape density. And in labs now, Fujifilm and IBM have reached the 89 gigabit per square inch area, whereas Sony has done 148. That Sony is basically translate to about 180 or so terabyte. In fact, at NAB, I was talking to Peter, the president of Fujifilm, basically, and he said that they now have increased the density quite a bit, where a 200 terabyte tape in lab is possible. So in terms of being able to increase the density of tape, we have basically a good future ahead of us that we can increase it to that much. So that's an important thing to know about the future of tape. Another leverage that tape has, that it is taking advantage of the head technologies that have been used for years and proven basically in this technology. Whereas disk has been gone through GMR and TMR tunnel and then colossal magnetic recording, whereas tape, we just shifted from GMR to TMR. So we're at the beginning of the second generation. We still have the third generation to go. So when you consider that, mix that with higher density and greater surface area of tape, you can see that we can have tape cartridges with much, much greater density. So, TMR is tunnel, and then CMR is colossal magnetic recording, and GMR is giant magnetic recording. So the Euler is basically GMR was the first one that was introduced, and then tunnel, and then CMR. There's just different technologies where they are able to magnetize the smaller bits, the smaller particles. So giant, yes, big. And why it's kind of interesting, you know, to use that for, yeah. So, so when you look at it, it considering the amount of data or content that we're being generated on a regular basis, it is good to have a bright future in terms of where density and the capacity and the performance is, because we're really going to need it. You are in this industry, media and entertainment, you know it better than anybody where things are going. I was basically, it was 2 or 3 weeks ago, I was in LA and in one of the studios, and they were shooting basically a movie. We were just talking about it today, where they're shooting at 4K, but the cameras are actually 5K, and they're shooting it stereoscopically, and they are actually shooting it at 120 frames per second. I had not seen it for most of the time. I've seen 48 and maybe 60, but I had not seen 120, so that was a new one to me. And then when you think about it, and the ratio of raw material to finished, it used to be 10 or 15 or maybe 20. Now we're talking 100. So that's huge amount of file that we're creating, and we do need basically a place to put them. So it's good to know that. So with that said, how does tape fits into media and entertainment environment? Most of you seem like you have experience with it. You have the application level, whatever that might be, whether it is MAM or automation or edit or project manager or what have you. To access tape, basically, you will go through a layer of software in the middle, be it a hierarchical storage management like an HSM application, the likes of TSM or ADA from a Tempo or SGL or any of those. But there is a layer of software that basically makes tape usable to the application where you can put content in there. And then, of course, you know, tape and storage behind it. Now, that model is something that has been proven. It's been around for years and years. In fact, HSM applications have been in supercomputing environment for many, many years with tape. But there are some challenges associated with it, especially now that the size of archives are increasing quite a bit. First and foremost, there's a degree of complexity associated with these. It requires a database. It requires servers, it requires movers, it requires training, it requires personnel to understand them. And for different application, it will require to integrate them with different applications and all that. So all those exist. It is proven, and it has worked. The other one is their proprietary nature. Most of these applications, in fact, most of them until recently that they write to LTFS, they do wrap the files in their own header and footer. That makes it proprietary in nature, which means that when you try to recover your file, you will need that application to be present for you to recover and reach your file. So that's an issue that when you think in terms of long term, you know, the availability of the application at, you know, for when you need it is something that is a major concern. The other one is the cost. After all, not only the cost of procurement, but with the tape library, when you buy a tape library and you pay for license on the tape slot, you will also pay for licenses to the application because it has to manage it. So it's sort of you're being double dipped. And that's something that a lot of the end users do not appreciate. They have not appreciated. They would rather not see that. So that's been a major concern that we've heard. In terms of support, when something happens, you have to do a triage to find out what is going on, what's wrong, basically, where the challenge is, where the issue is, and trying to figure out. And there's a lot of coordination and cross-training between us, the providers, with the software partners. So that creates a degree of complexity, trying to figure how to find out what is wrong to solve the issue rather quick. And then, of course, there are other things. The application-level dependency, I talked about that. But migration and adoption of future medium. That also is complex. That is a process that have to go through not only the storage providers, but also the application guys, and then the integration and the certification. And then, of course, you know, one of the major issues is migration. It is always cumbersome, and it is something that a lot of people, they sort of cringe when you hear about migration. So to be able to to deal, make those easier, those are the kind of concerns that has been raised over and over again in the industry. So those are some of the challenges associated with this model. And by the way, every single library that we've sold up to this point has been in this model. So up to this point, it's done a great job and it has worked, but those are the challenges that we do hear concern or looking for solutions to. So it is that basically the growth of the content, but also one great idea that we received from one of our end users, a multinational customer of ours in the US. And that I received the call basically one day, and the whole thing was that one of its their disk manufacturers was thinking about putting S3 interface. Are you familiar with S3, with RESTful APIs? No. So you're familiar with Amazon. Amazon basically is a cloud provider. And cloud storage models, basically the way you communicate with them is through a class of APIs. We call them RESTful API. And S3 is basically one of those. That's what Amazon's API is. It's basically a subset of HTTP commands that is used very heavily over the web. And I'll talk about that a little bit more. But he called, his name is Brenton Miller. And he said, Hossein, this disk manufacturer is thinking about putting S3 on the back of their subsystem, and they are going to make it possible for us to move the content to Amazon because it's a hot thing, and that's what the manufacturer wanted to do. But his comment was there was no way he was going to put his assets in a public cloud. That was not at all an option. But he said, but there's an interesting point to that. Wouldn't it be nice if you could support that API, and I could just push my content straight from the disk to your tape library. Now, there's a beautiful thing about that because it was a direct NAS mount SharePoint, if you will, and he could see everything through this disk volume, and he would not have to pay anything for it for that middleware application that was in the middle. Wouldn't that be cool? Because that will save me millions of dollars. That will get rid of the complexity associated with this. We basically took that idea and we just didn't let it go. That became basically the way we look at storage, and we talk about this new technology, which was cloud storage, but with tape, extending basically object storage to tape. That basically where the whole idea started, and that's how we're looking at it. So thinking about this depth of storage, the amount of storage and all that, we now labeled it as deep storage, and that's what this conversation is all about. It's going to look at the game.
Still no. No scores.
So, no, of course. So, to understand the technology, which is extending object storage to tape, I thought that we touch on a number of aspects of a couple of different technologies to see why things might make sense. First, let's take a look at the storage progression. Everybody uses disk. In fact, when I started my career, I designed disk tape controllers, block storage, but you had to add a layer of software on top of it to make it usable to the application. And in fact, application using disk storage, they have direct access to how and where the data lies. So they have full control of what block on the track on a disk platter, basically, the data sets. And the reason for that is because they want maximum performance. So in environments such as rendering or transactional processing and all that, it still does make sense. That's where you get the maximum performance out of it. So, but in terms of general usage, it's not as easy to use. And it is cumbersome to use. And it uses different layers of software. So people wanted an easier way to manage to put a lot of file on this subsystem. And that's maybe about 10, 12 years later is when network appliance basically first did a lot of network-attached storage, where they wanted to be able to use files, many files, basically, and be able to share it. And that's where NFS and CEFs and basically network-attached storage became thing. But with file systems, typically, they are good up to a certain size. Once they grow beyond a certain size, the directory structure and managing of this directory structure becomes cumbersome. It becomes very, very hard to manage. The bigger, the harder it gets. And then the other thing is, at some point, it basically hits a limit where you cannot scale it. Considering the amount of the number of files and the size of files and all that we've got in terms of capacity and number of files, this technology is not as easy anymore to use or to scale. And that's where we've seen basically where this new technology is basically coming around, and that is the object storage and cloud model. The whole idea is basically to have a storage model that is easy to scale and is easy to put files into and out of for unstructured. That's why this whole cloud, that's why the object storage thing is basically resonating with a lot of people, because it makes things much easier and easier to scale. And that's what we've been seeing. So one of the important aspects that Mario said is there is a universal ID associated with every file. With any one file that you put into this flat structure, flat list, there is a unique identifier. That's one important aspect of object storage. So it is exactly that. It's the voucher that you get when you park your car in a parking lot. That's for every file has one of those, and it's unique. The other one that is important about object storage is it allows for the inclusion of metadata with the files. So these days, the amount of the number of files and all, we've got so much of it, so many of it, that the only way to find this thing is to be able to search for it based on key values, based on information about the metadata. And you know that better than anybody how important that is. So it allows for the inclusion of metadata with the file. So another aspect of it is that object storage basically it decouples basically the physical medium from the application, meaning that the application does not care where the actual objects are. All it cares is that it does have a unique identifier, and I'll give it to somebody and he will put it away for me, and I just know that if I give it that identifier, then it'll give it back to me. And how that storage and that repository is managed is no longer of the concern of the application. So there's a clear breakout line between the application where the end user lives and where the data is managed. And that's an important aspect of this whole thing where we talk about it a little bit more. And of course, it's flat structured as Mario basically suggested, that you can scale it. It's just a long list and just add to it more. So those are many important aspects of object storage. I will talk about this a little bit more later on the following slides, but typically when we talk about object storage up to this point, people assume that object storage is about disk, and they think it's about erasure coding. Erasure coding basically has nothing to do with object storage, nor does disk. It's just that the first implementations were based on disk. So we will talk about that a little bit more. But let's talk about how object storage works. First of all, object storage, all of them, they have a RESTful API in front of them. RESTful APIs are very basic set of commands that runs on top of HTTP, as I mentioned earlier. It's as easy as put, as you put something away, or get, as you get something, or list, or maybe delete, or get status. But these are it's very few of them, and there are a whole bunch of them out there. In fact, the whole web is basically running on it. When you go to Google and you search for something and you get something, you are using RESTful API. When you go to any place to stream something, find something, that's what you're using. So another aspect of them is that they work based on a client-server model. So there is an entity that provides services, and then there is a client that requests services. So when you go to Hulu or somewhere, Netflix or something like that, that's basically a service pro, that's a server, and you are a client for it. So that's basically another aspect of that. And oftentimes there are gateways or and appliances between the client and the services that are being offered or the server that provides that. So that's another aspect of the object storage. It works. Sure. And we could use HTTP, secured HTTP or what have you, so the degree of security is there as well. So as I mentioned earlier, basically, when you talk object storage, traditionally, everything that you've seen related to object storage is disk. So disk has, you know, object storage has been the domains of disk. But there are still issues associated with disk-based object storage. Cost is an issue because the cost of disk relative to the cost of tape is still higher in terms of power, in terms of use, resources, and all what have you. In terms of cooling, exactly, environmental factor and size. Protection, if you still want to protect it, you have to replicate it. So you have to have two of everything to be in there, and it's a lot more expensive to get two separate subsystems versus, let's say, a tape that you can just copy a tape. So there's that issue still there. It is still, by the way, exposed to whatever external factors, such as viruses or such as somebody being unhappy or what have you. One of the things is basically still there's still application level agnostic, meaning that is totally related to the application, whatever application uses or the layer of software that manages it. Migration, still an issue that every 3 years, 3 to 4 years, you would have to migrate huge amount of data basically from one subsystem to another subsystem. Data integrity, mobility, of course, the ability to share it. Take it, share it, give it to somebody else. You can share it always over the wire and all that. That's one model. But in terms of actually taking a whole set of data somewhere, huge amount of it, that's an issue. Cost jumps into that. So anyhow, these are the kind of things that still has to be dealt with. So how easy to integrate object storage into the environment is very easy. There's tremendous amount of experience basically out there, and it is very easy to integrate basically applications into with object storage or cloud-based storage. We talked about APIs, how easy they are. In fact, it is said that there are over 500,000 applications that have been developed based on RESTful APIs. The whole point of it is that there's huge amount of experience out there, and it's very easy to implement. In fact, it may take only a matter of weeks or maybe a few short months to integrate an application with the RESTful API into an object storage. Versus if you try to do that at the file level or block level, that is going to take months. Easily years and all that. It's a lot easier to bring that into. So they're all over the place. Now, if we take object storage, and we take cloud technology basically with, you know, and also if you think about other technologies such as LTFS, have you folks heard about LTFS? Linear Tape File System. It basically is a technology, for those of you who have not had experience with it, it's just an easy way to make tape almost be used like a desktop system, where you can basically search for the directory of what is available on tape and actually have quicker access to any file that is in there. And I don't know if I should get any deeper into that. What LTFS does, basically, it creates two partition on a tape medium. It uses a short, smaller partition, and it puts basically the index of the files that are on the bigger partition that's out there, and it also allows for extended metadata to be part of that index that is there on that smaller partition. And then the larger partition of tape is basically where the data and the regular metadata is in there. So the way it versus the traditional model, you know, to find out what is on a tape, the traditional model is that you have to go start from the beginning and you read and you search for something trying to find it. In the LTFS model, you basically read the short, the index table, and then you will be able to know exactly what files you have in there. So it makes things much easier to find. The other thing that LTFS does give, it actually gives information, the short index gives you information about the structure of the file itself. It tells you what blocks are, where the blocks are located, and it basically what the file is all about, so it makes it very easy to read. So that's the benefit of LTFS. It makes it very easily readable. Basically, you can move it from system to system, or you can basically take it, and as long as you have the driver, the IBM driver, or any of these LTFS drivers, then you can basically keep that and read the tape. So that's another major benefit of LTFS. But if you put these two or three technologies together, then it's possible to basically do other innovations where it will bring value to tape. And it basically makes it, yes?
I was just
going
to say that kind of relates to the Amazon story that I said a second ago, because when they're writing information to whatever it is they're writing, they're writing it in a proprietary format. And so traditionally, even with tape on the back end,
That is the most important, basically, attribute of LTFS. It basically, in any information that you put on tape, basically, it is application independent. And you can get the source code. The source code is available. You can get it and basically put it in a vault, and you will always have access to data. So that's where the benefit of it is. So why do we think that the cloud interface is the right interface for what we call a deep storage and/or tape? It's easy. Everybody has a networking environment. Everybody knows how to use it. It's just basically plug it into the network and it gets discovered. It is a storage agnostic. It doesn't care. When we talk about deep storage, while within this context we're talking about tape, it really does. Deep storage doesn't really have to be tape. It can be tape, different kind of tape technology. It could be optical storage. It could be disk subsystem. It could be atomic storage, whenever it's going to come to the market. But the most important factor is the fact that storage medium has been abstracted or decoupled from the application. It brings that value there. It's very easy to scale. We talked about that, about the flat structure. But one of the most important things is that the inclusion of metadata with every object. And that's an important factor. And of course, there's the newer generation. I'll speak to myself, but I have children who know the web so much more than I do. They live in web from day one, basically, and the younger generation, they no longer care about basically block storage or file-based storage. All they care about is web, and they have a browser. They want to browse and search and find. If it's not easy, then they complain about it. and the younger generation get this technology, and that's where things are going. So the whole thing is, what if we took one of these RESTful APIs and we mixed that basically so that it would be efficient in dealing large number of files or huge files that go into a low-cost storage such as tape, storage media. Now, tape is a sequential device. You basically start at the beginning and you start writing, whereas disk is random access device. So to be efficient with tape, you would have to make sure that you always have data and you transfer files to it very efficiently. Now, with S3, Amazon, basically you will do a put command and a file and a put command and a file, and it basically, while it can work, it is not as efficient. Wouldn't it be better if you can create a command where you create a list of whole bunch of files, maybe hundreds of thousands or tens of thousands of files, and you do one command and bulk it, and you're actually more concerned about the size of the job versus every individual file. So if you have a project that might be 5,000, 10,000 tape or files or what have you, wouldn't it be easier to just do one command and then let the system know how best to transfer huge amount of data between the two? So that's one of the things that we've done. We took S3, which is probably the pseudo standard of RESTful APIs in the industry, and we basically added two additional commands to it, and we basically call it bulk put and bulk it. And all it is the same command, except it can accept huge number of files. So that's one change we made. The other thing that we had to consider is the fact that tape is portable. Tape is removable. So you can import and export tape into and out of a tape subsystem. So it has to be able to support that. And that ultimately is basically what we call the API as DS3. Otherwise, it should work just with any RESTful API or with the S3 API. Really cost.
LTFS for removable support, and the bulk puts and bulk gets, which are going to aggregate jobs to give us that sequential media support, added to the RESTful APIs that Amazon so graciously provided the world, give us the DS3.
Yep. So how does it basically work? It's very simple. So just like if whatever development environment you have, whether it is you edit or you search file or whatever the application is that you manage the content, and you put the list of files together, and it basically a bulk command is issued, and a bulk command sends the file or issues a command to the gateway. The gateway basically, what it does, the most important thing is right here, is it looks at the actual job. It looks at the attributes of the whole transfer, and it decides basically what resources does it need on the back end to make sure that the most efficient transfer happens. This is the most important part of it. And then it captures the metadata, where the metadata will go. If the metadata is included, the metadata will go into flash storage, where things are kept track of. And then it basically sends the file to the tape library. Now, all the files that come, basically, they land on a set of hard disk drives to make sure that we receive enough of them to be able to stream the tape drives on the back end. The most important thing is to make sure that once you start the tape, that you continuously feed it. So the whole idea of object, the bulk put or bulk get, plus the buffer, is all to make sure that the back end continues to move forward and write files. So that basically how easy this thing is. It's pretty simple. Now, all the aspects associated with managing the storage on the back end is basically managed here. Whether that is a tape subsystem, that is an optical storage. In fact, we do talk about it because it's an issue of cost. From our standpoint, basically, or from anybody behind this standpoint, it's really a matter of what storage subsystem is most cost-effective to use it for this purpose. So this is not technology. This is not all about tape, but it just happened that tape today is the lowest cost solution available. Now, there are a lot of other benefits to this. The fact that it abstracts the management aspect of its storage subsystem on the back end, it makes it a lot easier to deal with certain things. For example, first and foremost, the data is written to LTFS. It just happened to be on tape. That is the most common thing. LTFS is what we talked about. It brings basically independence from the application. You no longer need to have the application that wrote it to be available. But migration becomes something that is simple. It could be a background task anytime basically new technology is done, because the application doesn't care where things are. All it cares is the cell is holding on to that unique identifier. And the back end, we can move things from generation to generation or technology to another technology. In fact, it really doesn't matter. It could be managed without the end user being concerned about it. No, I'm glad you are. No, please do. That's because there's a lot of background tasks going on there where they do a lot of error corrections, or they do remapping of disk or tracks or sectors or what have you. And one of the benefits of this whole thing is that those could be background tasks. Now, one of the things that we've done in the past in our tape libraries is that we actually look at the health of the data. We actually load the tape, we read them, we check against the checksum that is laid down for every block of storage and all that, and we try to raise a flag. But we had never been able to basically couple that with the middleware application so that the middleware application can take proactive measure against that condition, meaning that if the data is on a tape is in question, then the right course of action is go ahead and copy it to another tape and put it away. We could never make that connection. We've had basically some of these features on our tape libraries for a while, but we create an error message, but the middleware does not necessarily take advantage of it. In this particular model, because all that is abstracted, then it's very easy, as you see flag is raised regarding the health of a medium, go ahead and copy it into another tape or a new generation of tape and basically retire that tape. The only thing that the end user will get is basically that a corrective action was taken, that they should take that tape and throw it away or destroy it or what have you. So there's a lot of stuff that can happen with that. in terms of whether it is the health of media, the health of data itself and all that, that's the sort of stuff could happen very easily. Migration, like Mario talked about, it could be a policy that is set that if new storage medium is done, whether it is those policies are, you know, on access or whether it is on age or threshold or something, that could be that something that could be happening on the background on a regular basis based on this basic set simple policies. So other things that basically you can do is dynamic. You can look at basically the job, the transfer, or what have you, and then you can look at the attributes of it, and you can allocate resources or dynamic. If you need to change the resources, then all those stuff could be just dynamically managed, again, without the application being involved. So those are once you take control and you create that abstraction layer, then all kind of things become possible. It makes it easy. So another very important aspect of this is cost containment. Early on, we talked about cost. So there is a cost with the storage subsystem. There is a cost basically about, if it happened to be tape, basically cost associated with the tape cartridges and tape library. Oftentimes, what we talked about early on was there was a middleware that would manage the tape library, and oftentimes they charge based on cost per slot, number of drives, tape libraries, and all those. So we would be able to fix the problem of cost if we managed to get the cost of this fixed or near zero. If there was no cost associated with this, then the cost of a storage, especially as you scale it, becomes closer and closer to the actual cost of the storage medium, because you amortize the size of the main subsystem, but over long term, as you grow your storage, the cost should get closer to the cost of the actual storage medium. So that is another benefit of this. So ultimately, basically, what does this whole thing means is, if you think about it, when the application sends a file down, assuming that the metadata is included with the file as it transfer, then we put that file down plus the metadata associated with that on LTFS tape. We can do that. So that becomes basically a self-describing object on a self-managing storage subsystem. And the fact that files are laid down in their original format on an LTFS tape subsystem, then the original format is preserved as well. So that sort of eliminates the need for the application. That's an important aspect of it. And of course, it is portable. Or if there are other storage subsystems in there basically that have different attributes, such as maybe disk for nearline access, that could be part of this model, because the model does support different types of storage. We've talked quite a bit about tape for cost purposes, for portability purposes and all that, but you could also include disk on the back end as well, where policies associated with this gateway could manage the file to be on disk or it could be on tape depending on the policies. So now you have a single portal that manages storage based on these policies on different storage medium. We talked about the application dependencies, you know, related to LTFS. So it basically ensures that you have recovery of your file anytime in the future without the need for an application. And it's this model where we think basically managing of the storage medium, the data itself, the portability within all that, we think this is the only model that basically can work and address all those issues. So ultimately the fact that it is a web-based model, because it is HTTP and it is in your environment basically, then you can create or deploy your own private cloud model, because this, because it's web-based compliant, it could be local on-premise or it could be remotely. So you can have global access within an enterprise where different people from different geographic locations that can access the whole thing. So the model ultimately is a private cloud model, where it takes advantage of many attributes of a cloud storage and cloud model and object storage, put this whole thing together, and it allows you as an end user to basically launch your own private cloud model, whether it is local or remote. And that's ultimately where the value is. So it basically would, you know, the thoughts are to take advantage of these new technologies that has been basically growing more and more. There are values to them. You know, the web-based model is huge, the simplicity of RESTful API, and then of course the object storage has a lot to do with ability to scale and retain the content. So so with that said, if there are any questions, if you anything we can explain, elaborate further, further, please. Yes, sir. Yes. Okay. So RESTful APIs are a subset of commands, some very basic, simple commands that are right on top of HTTP. HTTP basically is what the web runs on. Everything that you do on the web is based on HTTP. And these are very simplified commands that do certain simple functions. And what we talked about was, you know, like a put function. If you go on the web and you are trying to browse for a particular thing, when an issue command is there, basically you search for something, it does a search and then it basically lists. That's a command. If you try to click on a link, well, the content of that link is uploaded. That is basically a get command. If you try to put, for example, a file or a video on YouTube and you push it up, that is a put command. So RESTful APIs are very simple set of commands that you can do certain functions over the network. As a transport layer, basically, for it. In fact, one of the things that is happening in the industry would be actually good to know is that there is yet another trend that is going on in the industry, and that is, you know, basically software as service, where a lot of companies, or web-based architectural model, where a lot of companies that are writing software, they are creating their software module in a very modular way, but all the modules are communicating with each other with a very clear and a specific set of commands called RESTful API. So that brings a degree of flexibility and openness to the environment. It's a very common practice that is happening on the web. And that's where this whole, all this stuff fit together. And if you look at a lot of the MAM applications and all that this is, or many applications, you will see that they talk about web-based model and the modular APIs. So this whole model, looking into the future, really there is a shift that is going in that direction, just because it hides the complexities associated with developing an overall subsystem. That's why this whole thing, you know, I apologize if I talked about tape or talk about within the context, you know, or us or what have you, but this being the first time that it's done, as at least in case of tape and supporting multiple tiers of storage, sorry I had to use that, but that would just the way to explain it. Yeah. Right. the most important thing is to think about the gateway and how it can be a portal to different types of storage. And in terms of managing and policies and abstracting all the complexities, it's a simple layer that deals with it. Everything else, maybe the day of deployment, you have to be concerned about the policies, how to manage the storage, but beyond that, you no longer care about. Your workflow engine will be basically decide what set of information will go in what storage domain, and you will know that the policies will automatically take over and manage it through its life cycle. And that's probably the most valued part of this whole thing. Yes. Is that any other questions? Well, with that said, thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to talk with you.
All right, hope everybody is refreshed, and I'll be a little bit shorter, I hope, than Hussein. Mario kept interrupting, so. Thank you all for coming out. Thank you, CBC and CEV, for hosting SMPTE. I'm Jonathan Solomon. I'm a system sales engineer with Aspera. Aspera is a accelerated file transport protocol that leverages some software on top of it. You may have anybody heard of Aspera in here? Okay, good. Some good. So we're very big in media entertainment to move large files distances. Basically, we can get line speed to move files across the world or across the country. So I'm going to talk about challenges of sending large files over public internet. Truthfully, it's a challenge of sending any file over public internet, but if you're sending an email, it takes a little bit extra time. You don't even notice it's so small. And this is great. Hussein talked about maybe putting a tape library with S3 storage in a remote part. This is something that's going to play into this. You'll see we talk about HTTPS, HTTP transport, S3. We'll get into that a little bit through the presentation. So first, quick outline. We're going to talk about setting the stage. What the technology is about, and what TCP is, and ways to move things faster, features to look for in file acceleration software. And then I'm going to do a quick network security 101 at the end. Aspera is very security conscious. We move a lot of material that is needs to be secure, whether it's DPP packages for film delivery, or somebody's content they don't want out to get out before a release date, or maybe some government stuff. We have a lot of government business, so we're very conscious on security, so I'd be remiss if I didn't talk a little bit about it, given today's culture and environment. And then, of course, Q&A at the end. So let's set the stage. Show of hands, who knows what this is? Okay, all right, 1972. How about this? You guys know what that is, right? Okay, how many of you still have one? All right, so that's 1984. You guys know, may have watched this, right? Miami Vice, 1984. And some of you might remember these guys as well, right? By the way, when I put this slide together, playoffs weren't going on, so. And you've all heard of this, which was 1982, was when TCP/IP was invented. What do they have in common? Well, they were new technologies at the time. They were the best at the time. They had wide acceptance. They allowed growth into newer technologies. They had awesome cars and suits, at least in Miami Vice. And at the time, nobody could beat them. And that's not just true of hockey. It's true of all those technologies. But are any of them still useful? Seriously, any of that, would you use 3/4-inch tape? Would you use a Macintosh? No, they're really not. And if they were still useful, there's other new technologies out there to do better. So why is TCP still used? It's a long way to get there. How do you know if you're using TCP to transfer files? If you're using FTP, if you're using SCP, if you're using HTTPS, if you're using Box, Google Drive, commercial filing services, or Windows Shares, you're using TCP. It's a 30-plus-year-old technology you're using. There's nothing else in this building except maybe this carpet that's still 30 years old. So, and you're... So, what's the problem with the... Yeah, there you go. What's the problem with today's file sharing technologies? Well, the data size and the volume has grown tremendously in 30 years. 30 years ago, you were on a 14-4 modem if you were lucky, and you were moving maybe a K of data. And now you're moving gigs and gigs and gigs just to get the day's content out. Or in the case of some tape enterprise solutions, you're moving millions of tiny files to get them to where they need to be. Speed and performance, we're now global. We're not going within the building. We're going between buildings. We're going between locations, maybe from the East Coast to the West Coast. That's going on today. Security, of course, is always big. The way we're doing business with infrastructure is different. You could have a private cloud. You could have a public cloud. You could have software as a service. You could have infrastructure as a service. All kinds of different deployment options today. It's not just the bare metal that's in your rack room taking up heating and cooling, although we still have that. And the paradigms we're doing to share today are different as well. It used to be I would send you something, you would send it back, maybe I'd put it on a bulletin board, a physical bulletin board, you know, with a cork and everybody could see it. Today, it's person to person, it's person to group, it's group to person, it's syncing, there's all kinds of different sharing paradigms. And of course, auditing and control is huge. Everybody wants to know who's got my stuff and where is it going and how long is it taking and so on and so forth. And this is all driven by the huge data explosion, the diversity of networks, the ability to go anywhere global. You can have a data center in India now and nobody knows the difference. You can have a call center in India and nobody knows the difference. Yes, there you go. And cloud computing is huge. You know, that was half of Hussein's speech was on cloud computing. Netflix is using it, MLB, FIFA, everybody's using it now. Cloud is where it's going, for better or worse. It's something you have to admit to. So here's the challenge. TCP performs great in ideal conditions, and the ideal conditions are within your building. Once you get out of your building, it's no longer an ideal condition. It degrades with distance, and it degrades exponentially with distance. So if you go in a metro network, yeah, it's going to perform satisfactory. But as soon as you go outside of a metro network, it's city to city, it's not going to perform well. TCP does not scale with bandwidth. You can throw more bandwidth at a transfer problem if your transfers are slow, and it's never going to get much faster, not incrementally faster. And there are alternative technologies mostly based on TCP. The ones that do sort of work are data caching and data compression, neither of which work for media, right? Because media is already compressed, and if you could cache the media, then why are you sending new material? Because it's the cached material is good enough. And of course, CDNs work. They work very well for content distribution to edge devices like mobile, but they don't work very well to distribute your content to, say, a bunch of different affiliates. What this chart shows is in the back corner, the tall bar is a metro LAN, is a local area network. TCP at a 1 gig will perform at 1 gig in a local network. As you move further out, you're going to increase latency, which is the time it takes. The round trip time is the time it takes a packet to not only get to the location but to get an acknowledgement back to the server. That's going to be your round trip time, and the further out you go, just by the definition of the speed of light, the longer it takes. And packet loss, as you come closer out away from the graphic, or closer to you from the graphic, that affects TCP as well. And that's just packet loss just happens on a network. You're going to lose packets. It's how you make that up is how the protocol is going to work. So basically what the graph is showing, TCP, fantastic in your building. And as soon as you get out of your building, it's going to fall off, and it's going to fall off dramatically. So there's a concept of good put that we like to talk about. And throughput is the rate of successful messages delivered by the network. So that's what your throughput is. You're getting 50 megabits per second delivered on a 75 meg pipe because you have 33% packet loss. Good put is the rate of useful information delivered by the network. And all overhead reduces good put, particularly retransmitted packets. And that's going to be because of router buffer overflows, which we'll see in a little bit, storage buffer overflows, which basically means we're delivering faster than storage can write, and retransmitted packets due to packet loss. The last one we can't do much about, but it's how you handle those retransmitted packets. And we'll talk about UDP blasters and how they do it versus how other solutions do it. The goal is to maximize your good put by minimizing the amount of redundant data on the network. And that's very, very difficult to do. And TCP does not do it. They just keep sending stuff over and over. And if you've ever done an FTP to file, say 100 meg file, and it's got 90% there, and someone trips over your computer and unplugs it, and you have to restart and send all 90 gig again, that is the antithesis of good put. An optimal system will obviously maximize good put. So here are the fun charts and graphs that SMPTE people tend to like. So this is a graph of latency. Latency, laws of physics limit the speed at which light and signal can travel between any two endpoints. It will take a certain amount of time for to traverse the data. This is called latency, and the round trip time is the time to go back to where you started. So on the left, if you look at latency as the blue bar, it's from when a packet's sent, received by the receiver, and the receiver acknowledges that they got the packet. That's latency over time in that chart. Latency increases with distance, and the longer the distance, the higher the latency, the more TC packets are sent before an acknowledgement is received. And the sliding window is the amount of data that is sent but unacknowledged. So the sliding window wants to be your bandwidth delay. And once you exceed that, really bad things happen. You lose a lot of packets. And if you don't get close to that, you're wasting a lot of bandwidth. You're not maximizing your bandwidth. And TCP does both of those. They go really well to maximize your bandwidth, and then they run out of, then something happens on the network and they drop all the way down. We'll see the sawtooth in just a minute. TCP sliding window deals with flow control and congestion control. They're just important things to know that they're there. So this is TCP on a good network. It ramps up, it starts living at a maximum speed. There's some action in the network that causes it to drop off. It goes all the way back down and starts up again, but ramps up quickly. And so you're getting pretty good throughput overall, right? You're using most of the bandwidth in there. So when low latency, TCP performs well. Latency and packet loss restrict the TCP sliding window. So TCP never has a chance to achieve the high bandwidth. This is why standard FTP and other products don't work efficiently, don't have good put. What's happening here, this is the same scale, so to speak, but with higher latency, and you start to see it come up pretty quick with TCP, and there's an action, and then it drops off right away, and it comes up, and you get the sawtooth pattern, right? And you're not getting that maximum good put on the transfer. This would be a non-TCP transfer, so basically a UDP transfer, right? There's a number of solutions out there. Aspera is one of them. And what you're basically doing is you're filling the pipe. You've got a couple of drop packets, but you're sending them just in time so you can reconstruct them at the other end. And it works more efficiently. As you can see, you're getting much better throughput, a lot of good put. Interestingly, what Aspera does is it does not acknowledgments. Instead of waiting for every packet to get acknowledged, we actually wait for someone to say, we didn't get that packet. So it's assumed every packet is delivered. It actually is delivered, but the software is designed so it assumes it gets delivered unless it hears otherwise. So latency queuing, we talked about buffer overruns a little bit earlier. The left side is what throws from top to bottom, and this is multiple router hops as you're going from, say, this building to Toronto. The first router, there's not too much buffer going in there. The second router, well, it's 3/4 full, and the third router is not a lot. That second router is your limiting factor. You can only get as much data through to the end as that middle router because the buffer is starting to get full. And when you get a buffer overrun on the bottom, just the packets never get there. You get packet loss. So the trick is to figure out how much data that middle router can put through and only send that much data. So just because you have a 1 gig pipe, if you're going between two facilities and there's a middle leg that's only 100 meg, that's how much you can get through, if that's as much as the router is going to allow. So this is a more difficult example, but on the first one, you've got, look at the chart on the bottom, the staircase represents each of those hops in the router. And you can see as the buffer gets bigger, the latency gets longer because it's waiting its turn in queue in the router to go out. And the second one, the middle chart, the second from bottom, are just a massive router buffer, right? It's almost full, and you get this huge latency uptick rise while you're waiting for that buffer queue. And then the last one, the router is full, the third router is full, the packets never make it. This is basic networking. TCP, TCP specifically, but this would be with any networking protocol. The trick is to know how to adjust for that, right? There's without getting specifics of Aspera's product, there's ways to, and I'm happy to, we can monitor. We have a back channel that monitors the transfers, and if there's problems with the transfers, like a router buffer issue, we say, hey, don't send so fast. Just wait till this activity goes down. The bit rate drops until the action clears, and then it goes back up. So rather than dropping packets and throwing them away, we maintain good throughput until the problem clears itself. So that's a very fast summary on latency. So how many questions are there on that? Did I go too fast? You guys kind of get the high-level concept on it? Okay. So latency is the bane of transferring files, because latency causes the packets, the acknowledgments, to arrive later, which means the window gets longer, which means more packets gets lost, and it becomes a circular problem. So in order to overcome that latency, you need to have a solution that takes latency into account and expects it, is really the best way to put it. And there's your there's a little pop-up that comes up. So let's talk about ISP band, yeah, latency, exactly. Let's talk about ISP bandwidth versus available bandwidth. So here is your 1 gig circuit, physical capacity of the circuit. Fantastic. You can do all kinds of stuff on this circuit. Throughout the next few charts, it's all the same scale. So maybe your storage doesn't write at 1 gig. It only writes at 900 megabits per second. Well, you can't transfer faster than 900 megabits per second because you can't write that fast. So there's a first limitation. Maybe you're licensed somehow in software that prevents you from going any higher than 750 megabits per second. So even though your storage can write faster, you're limited by a licensing limitation. That's fixable. Traditionally, in some cases, that's more than a licensing limitation. It's actually a software limitation. And then you have to start doing multi-part streaming, and it gets to be kind of a mess. Then you have a client cap. So maybe you have someone sending to you, and you have a 1 gig pipe coming in, your storage rate is 900 meg, your license is only 750, but your client only has a 600 meg connection. Well, you can't exceed the client's rate of 600 meg. And maybe your server has a limitation because it's also serving out streaming media for all the executives to watch. So your server is currently capped at 500 meg to allow transfers. And perhaps you have a QoS going in that only limits transfers, FTP, or some other transfer at 400 meg. And your total network bandwidth is now decreasing substantially. The lowest maximum bandwidth will win on this. So you have all these great solutions, but if any one of those don't work, you can't go faster than that. This is irrelevant of TCP. This is more of a network structure or storage structure or license structure. But you need to be aware that all of these impact transfers. And it's not just on your side, it's on the other side. So if you're transferring to somebody who's watching a lot of streaming video on their ISP and they have a 100 meg connection, they're not going to get 100 meg going through. And there's ways to fix that. The easiest is a dedicated transfer circuit. So all that taken into account, here's your TCP performance. No matter what, you're really not going to get much better than that out of TCP. If you add in an alternative transfer method, you can get 90% improvement in this particular example. You can fill the pipe. This is if you were transferring, let's say, from here to the West Coast. The opposite of that is if you're transferring in the building, well, TCP performs pretty well locally, as we talked about. So in this case, TCP is using 80% of the bandwidth available. So adding an alternative method, well, you're not going to get an ROI on that. It's just, there's not going to get much out of it. It would work. There's other reasons you might want to do it, for audit, control, management. But from a performance perspective, if you're doing local transfers, you're not going to get much out of alternative transfer protocol. In certain cases, particularly with small files, you can see that. we have a way to work, or we now work around the same way that Spectralogic is doing, is bundling files for writing a tape faster. We can now do a million files in a minute at 1 gig or whatever like that, because they're all tiny and we package them up into larger chunks and transmit the larger chunks because we're not reading and writing as fast. So what are the alternatives? Before I go on, any questions on sort of limiting factors in file transferring? Okay, good. So what are the options? Well, you can have an inline product. They're often used between offices. They're great for file sharing and email. They're basically caching devices. They cache the email that comes in, they cache the web pages, they cache the file shares so that they're available much faster on the local side, I guess the remote side. But there's no real acceleration on fresh content. It just sort of works. And it works very well. And there's a lot of companies that do it, and it's very popular in remote offices for businesses. If you have an office in New York City and you have a remote office in Washington, D.C., you can do a lot of caching, and it feels like things are faster. You can do enterprise file sync and sharing, which is web GUI based, often used for group sharing. We're talking about Box and Google Drive and that type of stuff. There's limited file acceleration. It uses HTTP, and as we've discussed, that's not very efficient. But the biggest problem with those are security, audit trailing for file transfers, not knowing who took what and when, content control, and file size or total size limitations. The content control is a big one. I imagine many of you have Google Drive on your phone, and if you use it for company business on your phone, then you're probably violating your company's policy. I do it. So, and I work now for a very big company that looks down on that. But when you want to have the content, it's there. But there's no control over it. It's just out there, and it's on my phone. It's on my desktop at home. It's on my work laptop. Might be on my wife's phone. Who knows where it is? There's no control, and that's a huge problem with the EFSS solutions. So UDB blasters I referred to earlier, and this is by far the best quote alternative until you get into a proprietary protocol. And it basically blasts data over UDP instead of TCP, and it sees what sticks. But it just keeps blasting stuff. So it's just going to keep sending the same content over and over and over until all of it gets there. So it's extremely inefficient. It does work. It is faster. It is seemingly faster than UDP, because if you look at your network monitor, you go from 10 meg to 100 meg because it's filling the pipe. It's just filling it with repetitive information over and over and over. They don't have real integration into systems or workflows. Most of them don't have a RESTful API or any sort of API. Very high resource utilization and no congestion avoidance. They're very, very rude protocols. They just go. And they don't write to cloud very well. And I'll talk about that in a minute because I think that's an important discussion point. And then there's UDP transfer products, which are often proprietary. There is some open source code to do UDP transfers, and it works, and I know people who use it. You have to know what you're doing. You have to have a lot of patience. You have to have programming skills, and you have to have self-reliance because there's no one to call for support. But it is there, and it does work, and if that's your model, it works well. Most are server-client models, so there's an initiated handshake between the two, and there's a transaction that occurs, and it's usually monitored. And all of them improve performance. But many of them have file limitations, network limitations, may or may not integrate with your workflow, may or may not have good resource utilization, may or may not have congestion avoidance, and probably don't write to cloud. There's only one company that I know of that writes to the cloud. That's us, by the way. So why is writing to the cloud important? Well, I'll talk about that here. So writing to the cloud is HTTP. Hussein talked about that. It's RESTful. That's how it works. If you're writing to a private cloud in the next room, or you're writing to Amazon storage in Singapore, it's writing HTTP. And it's writing HTTP multipart, which means it's writing multiple HTTP sessions at the same time. We've already shown that HTTP doesn't, which is TCP based, isn't very efficient. So you can throw an accelerator in front of it. Any of the UDP products work great. But unless you're writing right to the S3 storage, you're writing it to a cache server in the cloud, hopefully in the same location as the S3 storage, and then you're copying it. So you have a time hit to write that storage. And if you're thinking, oh, okay, how bad can it be? Well, think of like, I don't know, a 4K movie that's 4 hours long would be in the neighborhood of 3 terabytes, 4 terabytes maybe. Okay, that's a long time to write to storage that's inherently slow and then copy it to slightly faster storage. But more importantly, for some period of time, as short as it is, that entire file is sitting in the open on a cloud server waiting for someone to grab it and make DVDs and sell them in Chinatown. And that's the reality, is it's a security risk. So what Direct Write to Cloud does is it takes that accelerator protocol and in memory transfers it to an HTTP multipart. And because it's writing locally to the in the same location as the storage, there's no latency issue, so it can write as fast. So it's still doing HTTP multipart, but it's not caching it. And that's an important distinction when you're looking to write to the cloud with accelerated transfer, is it caching, and is that okay with you? And sometimes it is. So that's UDP transfer products. There are some other solutions. FedEx, very, very high bandwidth, but very high latency. You can fit as many tapes as you can fit in a truck, but it just takes a while to get there. And in some cases, it's faster. We're working with a potential customer who's got multiple terabytes of data they're capturing a day in an area where there's spotty 3G coverage. Well, there's really no way to move that over a file. You put it in a truck and you get it somewhere where you can move it faster. It's reliable until you lose a hard drive, and then you've lost some packets you can't recover. There's satellite, baseband, fiber solutions, and there's dark fiber. Those are really three alternatives to TCP that aren't file-based. And some features to look for in a file-based solution. Security is a big deal. You want to make sure that it's going to be secure in transfer, and if you are paranoid, secured at rest when it's written to disk. You want to be sure it's adaptable to changing conditions on your network. You don't want to be doing a transfer at 8 o'clock in the morning and at 100 megabits per second on your 100 megabit line and have people come into work and not be able to check email. Trust me, IT is very unhappy when that happens. You want to be able to monitor line speed, congestion, and disk speed management. Earlier we spoke about disk speed as an issue. If you're looking at file acceleration and it can't monitor disk speed on the receiving end, then it doesn't know if the disk is writing fast enough or too slow, or if there's no feedback, it can't adjust. Management and control is, everybody's different how much control they want over it. You can have some software has very, very granular control, and some is sort of just press the button and it takes what it does what it does. Minimum overhead, minimum retransmissions. Scalability and clustering is a big thing now. It's great to have a system that works, but you should really have two, because if you're relying on it for delivering content that's making money, then you have to be aware if it goes down, how are you going to go around that? So being able to run a system in high availability where you have two nodes running at the same time, if one goes down or you need to take one down for maintenance, you can still maintain your SLAs, your deliverables. Uniform look across all OSs, customer support. If all of this is Greek to you, then customer support is a really big deal. Cloud support, inline validation, and of course, DAM and MAM integration. So those are some key factors in transferring. But the point is, if you're doing TCP file transfers of large data, you can improve it. Whether it's our product or anybody else's product, there's ways to improve it, and you can either do it very efficiently, or at least a little bit efficiently, and get a good return on investment. Whether it's just getting it there faster, or not waiting for it to finish, or getting it reliable, getting it there, and know it's there in one piece. Those are all key factors. So, that's the 30-minute version of challenges of file transfer. I'll take a couple of questions before I go into security, if there are any questions. I hope you guys are all ready to go home. I can. It's not, it's specifically not in the slide deck because I'm a Symphony member and I don't like sales presentations. But So, all right. I've had experience with Aspera and one other product. I was I didn't get into this before. I meant to. I'm a 20-year broadcast engineer that went from analog to digital to SD to 3G to 3D to 4K to wow, all this stuff is now file-based and I should reinvent myself to doing workflow management for file-based delivery, and I ended up at Aspera because I was a customer for 6 years. So I've had experience, a lot of experience with Aspera. I've had a little bit of experience with another product, and they all use UDP. The commonalities is they use UDP, which is different than TCP. It's different in the, it's in the same part of the stack, but it's I can't remember something datagram protocol. But it's a fire and forget. Typically with UDP has typically it in and of itself doesn't have a return channel. Right, so UDP is great if you're sending out streaming video because you don't need a return channel. Either it gets to the viewer or it doesn't, and you don't really care until they call you. What many of the products do is they use TCP as a return channel. So you initiate a session with TCP, and you do effectively a handshake. Hey, I'm here. I've got all the rights licenses. I want to do a transfer. I'm going to start sending. Okay, go ahead and send on this UDP port. And then you start sending the data. And as I said, with Aspera, we do not acknowledge, right? So everything's getting there until you tell me it's not getting in there. And what you tell me isn't getting there, I'm going to resend. For some perspective, the return traffic on UDP in the protocol is somewhere in the neighborhood of 50K. And it is substantially more than the TCP traffic overall. So it's all UDP based. The protocol itself is, I can only speak knowledgeably about our stuff. The protocol itself is aware of the other traffic on the network by the way it's doing the transactions through the TCP and the way it's getting stuff. Basically what it's doing is, in our world, is it's spewing out at the beginning, remember modems, and modems would do that handshake, and it would negotiate what speed are you? Are you 24? Are you 96? And it would do that whole handshake negotiating thing. Fax machines do it today, right? And you get to a common ground, and that's where I am. So that's effectively what the protocol does, is it goes out and it sends packets to the receiver, and the receiver knows how to interpret those and determine what the link is like. Is there buffering? What's the speed I'm getting? Is there a storage issue? And it does this all in milliseconds. And it basically does that handshake with the server, and the server says, okay, that's great. I know that you have 200 millisecond latency with 3% packet loss on a 258 megabit line. Maybe it's a gig, but there's only 258 megabits making it there. I'm going to send at 258 megabits per second, and I'm not going to expect to hear from you for 400 milliseconds. So I'm just going to start sending and let me know what you don't get after 400 milliseconds. And based on the checksums that we do, it does the math and figures out how to do the delivery. So is that a good enough answer? That's a good put. Yeah. Well, and that's the key, right? So if you do, did I give you guys the 100 megabit 10% packet loss speech yet? It's been a long day. So if you do 100 megabytes delivery and you have 10% packet loss, you're going to send the first 100. You're going to send 100 megabits, and 90 megabits are going to get there because there's 10% packet loss. And then you're going to send. What our product will do is send the 10 megabits again, and you're only going to get 9. And then you're going to send 1, and you're only going to get 900, and so on and so on and so forth until you send the last packet 3 times. And in the end, with FTP, for that 100 meg file, you're going to send 200, maybe 300 megabits because it doesn't know what to resend. So it just resends a whole bunch of stuff until it gets there. UDP blasters are going to do the same thing, just a lot faster. Accelerated protocols are going to do less, downwards with the really good ones that begin with vowels to about 113 to 150 megabits for a 100 meg file with 10% packet loss. And that's how you get the good put, is you're only resending the packets you need to resend. So that's the key. Otherwise, it's not efficient. If you look at the big picture, suppose you were actually paying for your bandwidth by the bit, how many bits you sent. Well, if you could send fewer bits, you'd pay less money. That's not quite the case, but if you think about it, if FTP takes this much time to send, that's how much I can send in this much time. But if a accelerator protocol, I can do it in this much time because I'm getting a better good put, I can send more stuff, which means I can monetize my assets faster. And that's how I talk to CFOs about it, is it's not about saving, because you're paying for that 300 meg line anyway, but you're not using it efficiently. You get away with 100 meg, but you've already locked into that deal for 5 years because some guy sold you a good deal. So use it more efficiently and send more stuff out. Yeah, so, right. So the accelerated transfer model, no matter whose it is, it's a client-server model. So you have agents on both sides, and they have to be aware of each other, and you have to establish the connection. That's why S3 is HTTP, because it's clientless. It's just HTTP. Everybody has HTTP, except that MacBook did not have HTTP. There was a hack that someone did to do that. It's client server based. It's proprietary. Yeah. So all the accelerated, except the open source one, is not proprietary, obviously. But all the ones, us, Signiant, File Catalyst, all those major players, they're all proprietary. Most of them are patented. Some say they are and they aren't. You guys can do the research. There is not. There is a trend for many companies to use the same product because they're interacting with each other. So you would have, say, in the States, it's easier for me because I know a lot of the States media entertainment. You could have NBC who's delivering to iTunes, and they'll both use this because iTunes already has an infrastructure of this product and NBC already has an infrastructure of this product. It's very easy to connect with each other. And a lot of times what you end up happening is you have multi-tenancy. So you have Signiant and Aspera and File Catalyst all in the same company because they're using it in different ways. And there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, I think there's something wrong with that, but there's nothing wrong with that. I don't see a standard coming out for that right away. You're going to hear something about Google's QUIC, QUIC protocol. That may become a standard, but that is a way to accelerate web page delivery, and it's doing the same thing. It's over UDP, but it's not really file transfer. All right. So with that, no problem. I will go into my lecture on network security. So this is me being my 90-year-old grandmother going like this. So there's three things on network security I want to talk about: passwords, networking, and personnel. I will save the worst for last, personnel. Passwords. As soon as you open a box with equipment in it that has an Ethernet connection, change the password. If you haven't heard, in the States, about a year ago, there was a zombie invasion in the Midwest. There really wasn't, but somebody hacked an EAS transmitter because the chief engineer didn't change the password and it was on an external facing IP address, and put out a EAS alert that said zombies were invading whatever part of town it was. It's quite amusing when you're on the East Coast and it doesn't really affect you, but those guys were not very happy. So if you have a piece of equipment that you order with an Ethernet connection, as soon as you open the box, change the password. You can write the password on the box. There's nothing wrong with that, on the piece of equipment. But if you don't change it, that means that when I Google Tanberg TX5780, I know what the root password is because the manual is online. Maintain a secure enterprise directory if you have a lot of passwords and a lot of people who need them, because otherwise you end up with a scattered password management system. Use complex passwords with upper or lowercase and symbols with more than 12 characters. That's actually one of the worst passwords in the world, by the way, because you should avoid passwords that spell something when complex. So really randomizing it is great. And admittedly, I don't randomize my passwords. So I don't practice what I preach. But if you have equipment on the edge that is publicly accessible and it's not a randomized password with more than 12 characters of mixed uppercase and lowercase and symbols, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when you will be hacked. And you may or may not know it. Change passwords every day or every 90 days or more often. This is a big one that nobody does. Have a plan for when a power user with password access leaves the company. If you're like everybody else in the world, all of your systems have the same admin password. And one day, some guys are going to get pissed off and leave the company. And is he going to log in remotely and wreak havoc? Likely not, but maybe he's got a bad gambling habit and someone's shaking him down and he's going to reveal the password. So come up with a plan for when that happens. When he leaves the company, not when he's shaken down. And if you need to, writing passwords on a piece of paper is more secure than putting it on your computer, or even worse, on a company share, because once somebody, and you'll see this in personnel, once someone outside the company gets into the company, they can see all your passwords that you've saved on your computer. So it's actually, people say, you know, don't put it on the bottom of your keyboard. You're just preventing your coworkers from using your account. And you have to determine the risk on that. Networking. Always use a firewall. Use a good one, set it up properly, and if you're not sure how, spend the money to hire someone who does, because that's going to save you a lot of hassle down the road. I'm sure everybody here has a firewall, but if you don't, there's a good point. When you set up your firewall, close down all incoming ports that are not needed, and make sure you log each exception so you know what it is, because when you regularly check your logs, you're going to see what people are trying to hit. A great example is Aspera uses SSH, Secure Shell, for logging. That's a publicly available port 22. Every server in the world has it. Some have it open, some don't. We strongly encourage our users to change that port, and we fully support it, fully support changing that. There are certain cases, if it's an internal only, where I don't push it, but if it's an external facing box, the first thing I do when I'm doing a demo is I turn off port 22, because it's a security risk. If you're in a production environment, maintain two networks when possible, a closed production network and an internet accessible corporate network. That means that those guys who are running Media Composer can't surf the internet, and tough luck, they can read a book. Use a DMZ when needed. Demilitarized zone allows certain access to certain machines for certain to certain ports on the web. Do not dual home machines, which is a machine with two networks. See DMZ. Scan emails and attachments when they're coming in or going between networks. And if you can afford it, use an intrusion detection system. They work really well. And IT likes to call system engineers and say, hey, we noticed there's a lot of activity on this box. And the system engineer says, yes, I'm upgrading it. And they say, oh, okay. But it works really well. Intrusion detection system is basically monitors the network for unknown traffic or excessive traffic coming in that's not expected, and can go as drastically as to shut down the ports that's happening on. It might mean shutting down the internet to the building, but if you're actually being attacked, it's a really good thing. And then finally, personnel. Training. Everything I just said, everybody needs to know. Don't ever share passwords. If you need access to a system, ask an admin for access to it. Don't ever open an attachment or link you're not 100% is safe. Most IT security issues in enterprise stem from someone clicking an email, clicking a link on an email or opening an attachment that they're not supposed to. And if that's not the reason why a building was compromised, then the, hi, I'm from Microsoft support and I'm calling to help you, is the second reason. Support doesn't ever randomly call you. That's what salespeople do. Support will not call you. If support calls you, hang up and call your support desk and say, hi, what did you want? And they'll say, nothing, I didn't call you. And that's true whether you're at work or at home, right? You guys all know this Microsoft scam because everybody here has a Mac and they all call us. And then finally, most of you guys, I'm sure, know this, a website will never ask you to verify your account through an email. If PayPal says there's a problem with your account, please click this link, then go to a web browser and put in paypal.com, and it will. If there really is a problem, it will say, hey, there's a problem with your account, and if there's not, then you can just delete the email. And that's it. Any questions? Good. Nobody's sleeping, so that's a good presentation. So thank you, everybody. My presentations are fast because there's a lot I like to talk about. So typically when you multi-home, you have an external network and an internal network. It's typically how you would do it. As soon as that external network is compromised, they have access to the entire internal network. There's no restrictions on that multi-homing. If you do it through a firewall or a router rule, for example, if you have a graphics machine in a closed network that has to do Twitter updates, then you can open up that machine to allow outbound port 80 access, HTTP, to get to Twitter, which is RESTful, by the way, through the firewall, right? So it's still on the corporate network, but you're saying this IP address can go out and do 80. Nothing can come in, right? You can only initiate stuff. Yeah, if you go to a bad website and you can launch some malware, sure, there's some stuff you can do. You have to trust that your graphics operators aren't going to do that. If you dual home the machine, it's wide open to the internet. So someone can get into that machine through a Microsoft security hole because your graphics machine is still running XP, which is no longer supported, and there's a lot of open ways to get into XP. Now they're into that machine, which is exposed to your entire production network. So that's the reason. All right. Thanks, everybody. Score update? What's that? Yes. Yes, or that old Mac would work as well, for the record. So, score update?
1-0 other guys.
Which one's the other guys?
All the good
guys. All right. Yes. I didn't even talk really about that. The good accelerator support encryption. They support it in transit on the wire. They support it by a client side encryption, which would be I'm sending a file to you, I put the passphrase in, you know the passphrase. You can't open it unless you have the passphrase. And they support encryption at rest, which is the server goes to an encryption server, gets a key for that file transfer, and when it lives on the storage itself, it's encrypted. And unless you have that key to decrypt it, you can't encrypt it. That's it would be recommended, because if you maintain the key on the server and the server was compromised, then you're really not. Which I mean, in all honesty, for Aspera, it was a long time coming, because engineering basically said encryption at rest server side is useless, because once you find the key, like if you're encrypting on a server key and the server's compromised, then you're not encrypted against anything. Once the encryption services started coming out, Amazon has one, it became more viable. So, all right, any questions, feel free to let me know. Thanks. Thank you.